It's Sam Jones, Flash Gordon, and you better be watching Geek Out SA.
Welcome back to Geek Out SA. It's Wednesday night again. We're here live, and we have Alejandro back.
What's up? Come on,
the urban journalist.
So excited. Yes.
I couldn't sleep last night. I was like, oh my gosh.
It feels like it's been a year. It hasn't, though. It hasn't quite been a year.
Been a couple months. But, yeah. You know, I feel like I see you guys every day because I tune in every Wednesday, and
Thank you.
I'll send you messages.
Yes, you send me messages.
And I get upset because I don't, you know, because of work, I don't oftentimes get to see it live, but I love to see it live. So
yeah.
I'll go home and I was like, oh crap, there's a new episode. I need to catch up. So I always watch.
Yes, he always watches and tells us. He's like, oh my God, I can't believe you talked about this, or oh my God, I can't believe that and stuff. And so,
why did Vincent say that?
And what is wrong with Vincent? Please get him on a leash.
Like, no.
Only once.
So that's funny.
But
yes.
It happens.
Yes,
Vince needs to be on a leash sometimes. Yes. You never can tell.
But not tonight, because I'm digging the velvet blazer.
Yes.
And it's very fashionable. I love it. It brings out your color. I love it. I red, you know, and on us, Latinos, red always looks great.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, I can't do yellow.
Oh, yeah, no, I don't think that
I hate it.
Yeah, it would not look good on y'all, so.
I don't know. It depends on the yellow.
Well, like really bright yellow is okay. But like that really toned down.
You don't like the one with my checkered black and yellow, and it's kind of more of a deep mustard yellow.
Yeah, but color. I guess because the checks kind of offset it, so it's not as like washed out as it would be. And I'm sorry, I don't mean to be ignoring y'all. I'm trying to post still because I'm slow. I'm slow today.
She's really slow at posting.
I was gonna put
I'm
my
really
phone is slow. So tag
like,
me.
Like my phone is usually good, but I'm like tagging all my friends. I'm like, start watching my show.
No. But I've been counting down the days to Star Wars, the Force Awakens, and I don't know. I'm getting really excited. We got our costumes; they're done.
But we're not showing y'all.
They look.
We're not
awesome.
Showing
he
y'all
got to
till
see them.
The day. Not on us though.
No, he hasn't seen them on us.
But it's legit. Colleen could give a run to the House of Dior with.
Oh
with
no, sir! That is all Al's wife, Lene. Yeah. If it wasn't for her help, it would have been a hot mess of robe. So Lene like helped a
it's
lot.
Legit.
It is totally legit. So thank you to her. The only things I did like the small pieces by myself after her guidance. I was feeling like a little more pumped, so I made like the shoulder armor and the OB and the Dickie and stuff like that.
I just love the texture.
But you know, she did a really awesome job, and
it's gonna be great. Really, like, I can't wait for everybody to see it. I'm excited for the reveal.
I'm kind of jealous that you guys get to dress up, because I when it comes to these things, like, I never get to dress up because, like, you know,
you have to be professional
and stuff, and it's just like, I really want to dress up and blah blah, and but then if I go, like, you know, I don't know. I dress up and then I don't get to enjoy it because then I need to capture it. So never win.
Well, that's why we've liked using the iPad that we use when we go for mobile stuff, because then we still can kind of dress up and be in costume and stuff and still carry it around. So that's good, because we don't even know how to use half of that stuff that you use. So.
Oh, I mean, I've learned. I'm still learning. Yes.
But no. We've been doing a lot of that stuff. I'm glad you're back.
Yes.
Glad you're back. And you got something come around. You've thrown some stuff out there.
Yes. Well, I'm happy to announce that, you know, for the past couple of months, I've been working on a follow up to Syfytonians. Mm-hmm. This one is exciting and fun because it's focused on Star Wars, which is the thing that I'm in love with, and it shows. It's not just Star Wars in general, it's San Antonio in Star Wars, which is something we've never really seen. We see San Diego, we see other places.
Yeah.
But San Antonio, I've been shocked how big into Star Wars San Antonio is.
Mm-hmm. Oh, heck yeah.
Because at first when I said, oh, I want to do this, I was like, crap, like, what am I going to find? Like, am I going to find good stories and people that build ships, like Jedi Starfighters, droids, collectors,
yeah.
Like in San Antonio, it's been amazing. I can't wait for next year for people to finally see it all put together. And
yeah, I remember seeing the first one. It was awesome. Awesome. And it was so much more than what I thought it was going to be. And what a lot of people thought it was going to be. And I was really proud. Like I said before, I was really proud to have somebody from San Antonio be able to put out something like that.
Well, yeah, it's nice to show us in a light that we're not, you know, I think number one, being in Texas, we get this bad rap of being like bumpkins and San Antonio is so lame. All it has is this historical stuff, but history is not lame. I mean, you know, the battle. In fact, one of the teachers that I work with actually is using Star Wars right now to talk about the comparison between Star Wars and the Rebellion versus the Texas Revolution with the seventh grade kids.
That's good. Well, okay, because I know you have your friends with a math. Is it a math one that he's in
I have a theater arts one, and I have all kinds of friends.
Okay. yes, it's interesting because it's a film that I was reading the other day. It's a non-denominational religion because it doesn't focus on like, oh, Catholic, Jew, you know, anybody can relate to it in this, because the force is kind of a spiritual thing. You know, I connect it to, you know, I believe in the laws of attraction and, you know, in the secret. And if you do good, good comes back to you. And the force in some way, it's kind of like that. But I also love, and this is something that I found in making this, it's Star Wars. It's a universal language, and you know, you can be anywhere in an awkward situation, but if they're wearing a Star Wars shirt and you start a conversation, oh my gosh, it's like a sorority. It's like you've known each other for years, and
yeah, and they'll talk about it, and you know, that may be the only thing you have in common, but that's something you have in common with somebody. So
I worry about it being lost to the younger generation. Those of us who care about it, we're passing it on to our kids, and our kids will pass it on to their friends and some of the other kids. Like our sons recently, because we got the fancy lightsabers, they were showing them off to their friends, and their friends were like, oh my God, like that's wonderful. That's amazing. So they've been watching all the movies, like having a bunch of their friends come over and watch the movies. And some of them took a trip to Houston to buy those Ultra Sabers over there in Houston. Because Houston here in Texas is where they make those beautiful lightsabers with all the soundboards and the lights. And yeah. So
well, we even have one here in San Antonio that actually does them as well. But he really customizes them.
Well, he does like, yeah, you can go and you can, well, and I think I saw him at the Alamo City Convention this year. But they looked like real props. Like, I was like, oh my gosh, like, how did you get the detail and everything? Like, I was like, what, how did you get that? And they put the thing on a stick and it looks legit. Like, before you had to go to Brookstones to get like an official, and now you could just get them anywhere. Well, you can even build them on YouTube. There's like tutorials and stuff.
You know, it's fabulous what the internet has opened up to us and what we can do now with the internet that we couldn't do before. Like, I would have been lost. Like, Vincent made
the food capsules.
And next week, he's actually going to release the video for people to work on this because having those videos out there, like, if you've figured something out and you've found things that you can make stuff, you should share it. Yeah. You post it and share it so that the community can keep working on stuff and growing.
But that's one thing that I didn't necessarily see be made on YouTube.
Right. But it's people
they'll show it after the fact. Oh, I made this.
Right.
And you can use this and this, but not the process that they went through to get it done.
And that's the thing, is just people finding something, like even the little details, because some people like really are into every little detail, and just finding that and putting it out there so somebody can say, oh, well, that's not so bad. I can make that too, and I can have those little details too.
Well, like I saw the belt that, what do you call that? You had a name for it. Well, I just call it the Jedi belt.
There's an Obi under the belt, but I don't know what you call the belt itself.
It's a belt.
The Jedi belt.
Jedi belt.
So the belt was, just the belt alone was on point. I mean, the buckle, the texture.
And that's a guy, he just started to make them, and then he was like, you know, I have a talent. Other people might not be able to do this. I'll put it on the internet and tell people, hey, if you want to buy these, like, I'll make them for you, hand make them for you, custom made. Yeah, you're going to pay for it, but it's real leather. It's custom made for you. It looks real. And the, it looks real. Texture
Is insane.
It's phenomenal.
Hampton's Jedi Outfitters.
Hampton's Jedi Outfitters.
It was quite a bit, but it's...
It's totally worth it.
It's amazing.
It's amazing.
Well, it has the Hampton's name on it, so you know. But but you guys are also gonna be in this coming story, so that's what even makes it. You guys are in the trailer.
Well, I saw that we were on the trailer.
We are on the trailer.
Yes.
We're such geeks. Like, my friends always make fun of us. They're like, you are such geeks. Like, what is wrong with you? Like, we literally found out that trailer was coming out. And so we had to get our lightsabers. Like, we needed our lightsabers with us to see that trailer so that we could be like,
But I loved y'all's reaction. Were you crying in the trailer?
Maybe a little bit.
Because I was like, you know, as a storyteller, you hope that happens. But I saw it and you did something. I was like, oh my gosh, what's going on?
Yes, I cried a little bit. Like, I've always felt this connection to Han and Leia and Luke. I don't know. Like, I showed the toys and I told people if they were watching last week what was like for me, like, not to have money to buy the toys and stuff. But those were the ones that my parents got for me. It was, you know, Han and Leia and Luke, and they were there and they were together and they supported each other. And something about that kinship and that love and that friendship, even when Luke and Leia didn't know that they were siblings, but there was that connection between all of them. And even though Han is kind of like a jerk, but he does the right thing. Like, yeah. I don't know. I've always felt a connection to those three characters. So when I saw them and they're older, it like really hits you.
I just hope it's good.
Oh, it's going to be phenomenal. Like, I'm going to lose it.
Big Daddy Russell just says, a lot of people that are not into nerdy stuff at all will be very into Star Wars. It's a world that every single person can be into. But, you know, I actually met somebody today that's not seen a single Star Wars episode. But just today, I was in, like, physical therapy for my shoulder, because that's another story. I have shoulder issues. And she was talking to me while I was in a splint. Like that. And she was like, oh, I was wearing one of my Geek Out SA polos. She said, oh, what is that, Geek Out? I was like, well, it's a show that I'm on. What do you talk about? Like technology and stuff? I talk about that and movies and Star Wars and stuff like that. So, oh, Star Wars. Yeah, no, as a kid, I wasn't really into that. And I wanted to read, like, also Harry Potter, but I never really did that either. So I was just like, it's these people that are, like, on the cusp of, yeah, maybe I'd want to, but they don't do it. So there's quite a bit of people that, even though we think it's mainstream,
it's more not as mainstream now than when we were kids.
Yes, definitely.
You know what gets me mad? Because I've met people, and recently I met someone obnoxious. Nice, but obnoxious in the sense of, you know, because we were talking, it's like, oh, you're going to see that Star Wars. I bet that's not going to be that great. And I was like, have you ever seen Star Wars? And this person was like, no, like, I'm not into that stuff. Like, it's just like, well, do you know, like, it's more than just a space movie. You know, mm-hmm. The whole space thing is a MacGuffin. There's a philosophy behind it. You know, it's a story about knighthood, chivalry.
Yes.
And this person is like me, who is into fashion and all this stuff. And I was like, I loved it because I had a kind of like a great counter argument, because I was like, well, you like fashion. You like Vogue. Did you check Vogue.com? And so I was able to pull it up, and I showed her, because Vogue did something where they each American designer built, they reinterpreted the new characters of The Force Awakens through ready-to-wear clothing, and the proceeds were, the outfits were going to be donated, and the proceeds go to the CDFA Award, to the CDFA, the Fashion Council of America. And, you know, you had Halston, you know, iconic designers like Halston, Diane von Furstenberg, very powerful American designer, and they were all doing versions of Star Wars. I thought that was cool because it, to me, it showed like, okay, it's for everyone. You know?
There are aspects of it in there for everyone.
So I took offense when this person was like, oh, I was like, well, girl, it's in fashion, so check it out. Oh, and the first photos that we saw were on Vanity Fair.
Yes.
Photographed by legendary photographer Annie Leibovitz.
Yes.
And, you know, so Vanity Fair, one of the big fashion magazines, part of Condé Nast, you know, so it's Star Wars is for everyone. Mm-hmm. So.
Mm-hmm. But I just don't think people get that, especially people, I think, in that, like, 30 to 40 range, because when we were all growing up, if you liked Star Wars, if you liked Doctor Who or Star Trek or anything like that, you were, you know, you were the nerd, you were the geek. People pushed you down. People made fun of you. Yeah. If you like it as an adult, well, why don't you grow up? You know, it.
But it's because of Star Wars that we have Pixar. Because, you know, Pixar, George Lucas started that and then he sold it. You know,
it was Industrial Light and Magic.
Industrial Light and Magic. Yeah. So everything that we have, you know, that's why I say this movie is more than just a film. Everything that we have in our everyday lives, even you know, how right now, what we're doing right now, the digital, you know, this online show, George Lucas started the whole independent digital thing, you know, back when he was, I can't remember the exact date, and I get mad because I'm all about, like, specific dates. But, you know, it's he somewhat made it, Star Wars in general made what's happening right now, what do they call that thing? If it's not dictatorship, what's the other thing?
Like,
I had the word. It's a very,
the word, like, just left
it's not
me.
In
democratic.
My head.
He made, you know, you know, the whole film thing, it's very democratic in the sense that, and if you want to do a movie, if you want to do something, you know, we now have access to that, you know. It did, back then, everything, you know, was done by a studio, and now everybody has a chance to, you know, express themselves.
And even to this day, they're still wondering how they did some of the stuff in the original Star Wars trilogy, some of the special effects. And stuff that Industrial Light and Magic just hangs on to, and they're not really releasing
not
anything.
Not gonna let you know. But can you imagine everything that went into it? All the art that went into it, building all of the sets and all the miniatures. And we saw a documentary where they have to blow it up, you know, and for the film, and like how much that made them feel. Just because of the time that they had spent and the energy they had put into it, and they were immersed in this universe in its miniature scale, and then like having to destroy it, you know, for scenes where things happen like that, you know, that's a lot of somebody's life to have put into a film for us to all enjoy, and something that we could still enjoy. Now, I have some of my students, I actually recorded them saying this because I wanted to traumatize. Okay. One of my friends, James Garcia, he's one of the teachers that teaches with me. He and his friend do the Ewoks.
Yeah, okay, no, okay.
And they do a lot of the cosplay and stuff, fabulous. So I taped them, my seventh graders, saying how horrible Star Wars was and it was boring and it was the stupidest movie they've ever seen. I was like, say it, just say it one more time and then you're all going to get a zero. And so I made him say it and I taped it and then I went over to his room and I played it for him.
Oh my
and I was like, you want a heart attack? Ready, go.
He was crying.
I remember
he was like, tears.
He was one of the first people that I interviewed for Syfytonians because I was there at Force Friday at Toys R Us. And he was so excited. I remember he was looking for BB-8 droid. And I remember talking with him. And he's like, yeah, I'm a teacher. I was like, what the hell are you doing? Because it was on a Thursday. I was like, what are you doing at midnight? Like, don't you have school tomorrow? And he's like, oh, you know, coffee. It helps. So.
We're allowed to take days off too, sir. Yes. And his Christmas tree and everything is totally Star Wars. Like. I mean, we have children, so our Christmas tree is going to be all of their little ornaments from when they were kids. But we do have Star Wars ornaments on it, too. Like
we do.
I love this display right here. I came today, and I saw that they had all the vintage, some of the vintage action figures from the original trilogy. And I almost had a heart attack.
I don't know if people can see or if they know, but okay. I leaned Leia up there with Jabba, and she's not in her slave Leia outfit.
Darn it.
Actually, okay. So my parents, people may not know this, but my parents were super Christian. Like, 1 year, my dad was an artist. He, like, painted a banner of, like, Mary and Jesus and put it, like, outside our house during Halloween. And, like,
oh my
God. Okay, my parents are super Christian, right? That kind of Christian. So there was no way.
Did they give out candy?
In Haiti. No, still? There was no candy. My brother and I had to trick-or-treat inside the house. We got to go to the doors. Like, my parents would stay behind the doors in the rooms, and we could go to the doors and knock on the door, and they gave us candy. It was, like, it's weird.
Oh, but at least they let you trick-or-treat, yeah.
They let us trick-or-treat just in the house.
In the house.
Just in the house. And mind you that I played Dungeons & Dragons and stuff, like, started when I was, like, 12.
Oh, my
gosh. So that freaked my mom out a lot. Yeah, the first few games we played, we had to, like, play in the house because she wanted to make sure that we weren't worshiping Satan, like, like all this stuff. So as you can see, I do not have any slave Leias. A lot of these toys are vintage. They were mine or our son's when they were little. So to the people that are worried about slave Leia, just don't buy it for your kid. Like, it's okay for the people who are okay with it, and it represents something that happened in the movie, and she wasn't loving the whole thing. Like, that's the whole point of the interaction. Like, he puts her in this to objectify her. She's not loving it. She strangles him to death with a big old chain. Hello? Like,
but
Carrie Fisher is even the one that went through and said that on air.
Yeah, she was like, tell your kid that I didn't like it, and I killed him for it.
Yeah.
But, you know, I felt...
And then I took it off.
I felt that it was somewhat empowering. I don't know, because she was able to, like, it's not like she didn't get rescued. She went and
she took care of it herself.
And but, you know, it's interesting that you say that, and that's a great conversation, because, you know, we look at the Marvel movies in today's world, mm-hmm. and you have these actors like Chris Evans and what's the name of the one that plays Thor?
Chris Hemsworth.
They give them all these millions to work out and keep that body physique for those shirtless scenes. But then, you know, when you have a woman in a bikini, you know, she's not even showing.
Yeah, she's not showing
nothing.
Anything.
You know, we go to the beach, we go to the pool, like, you know, it's so I just find, I don't know, I
super hypocritical.
It's 2015, guys, come on.
I agree. Yeah, people need to get over it. I mean, I was really happy. Sorry, honey, but they put out the new pictures for the new Tarzan movie with Alex Skarsgård, who was in True Blood.
Okay.
Did you ever watch True Blood?
No.
He was Eric, the blonde vampire in True Blood. So, yeah, they paid him a lot of money to work out for a very long time, and he looks like Tarzan. Like, he has the abs, he's cut here, he's got the arms, like, and he has no shirt on the whole movie because,
but that's, you know, that's,
you know, he's Tarzan, like.
But, you know, unlike these movies nowadays where they know that sex sells, and that's why they're doing it, because they're trying to grab the female viewer. Back then, I don't think George Lucas did it because, I'm trying to, because you don't look at, like, a lot of the posters and stuff, they didn't have her, you know, they weren't focused
on that. Right, they weren't focused on that aspect.
It was part of the story. It's not like they wrote it in there.
Yeah, he's a big gross thing who took her, and he wanted her to be, like, his sex slave, and she dealt with that.
What about,
like,
the Victoria's Secret runway shows that they do every December?
God, it just happened yesterday.
So, it's, I don't know.
$15 million bra. Hello. So,
I thought it was done tastefully.
Yeah, I thought it was fine. And so, to the people who don't want to buy it for their kids, but don't buy it for your kids.
Yeah.
Just don't get it. Yeah. And if either your kid happens to see it and ask you questions, then just explain it. Like, you know, she was made to wear this by a bad man. She didn't like it. She made the bad man pay, and end of discussion.
Just make him watch the movie. Yes. But I have a another comment from Big Daddy Russell. 501st does amazing things for lots of people in need all over the world. Big props to them. And while we're at it, if you haven't seen the trailer for Syfytonians 2, let's go ahead and cue it up right now, and you can see it now, right here on Geek Out SA.
What Star Wars did was it brought a sense of innocence. This right here is about the only innocent part of me that's left.
And we're back.
We were not having side conversations.
Yes. No, we were not at all.
Ever. We're actually talking a little bit about all of the different ways people can get into Star Wars fandom. Because we've talked about the toys. Obviously, everybody's seen the movies.
Battlefront.
Yeah, there's the video game.
I've not played it. And I'm not a video game guy, but I'm dying to play it.
I'm dying to play it, too, because I found out that you can play it third person.
Yeah, so it won't make him sick.
Because I get sick playing first-person shooters.
Oh, yeah, I hate that. Yeah.
Yeah, so there's a mode where you can switch it so that this one has a different perspective so it doesn't make you, like, feel queasy from the motion. So it looks really cool, so we're probably going to have to get it. And then you were talking about, like, fashion, even just, the sweater, the way Vince is dressed. I've seen, I actually wore to school on Monday. I got a Star Wars dress from Hot Topic.
No way.
Yes. It was a Stormtrooper. It's just white and black, very simple. But I just wore like a shirt under it and some leggings and boots and a nice necklace. Dressed it up. Got to wear it to work. Still got to be a geek, but like looked professional. The kids thought it was fabulous. They were like, oh, you look so pretty and professional. That's a Stormtrooper? Oh, wow. Like, you know, so you can bring fashion into it. Gaming. There is all kinds of Star Wars games.
Yeah.
There's role-playing game.
The miniatures game.
There's miniatures, tabletop miniatures. Yeah. Where there's just like the ships and you're out there and you're like fighting the different squadrons and you get to be admirals. That's for Armada. And then there's X-Wing. There's two different ways you can play that. And there's Imperial Assault.
They had an original version of the RPG, which is a completely different system from the D20.
Yes, the Western.
Which game. I like the original.
Oh, really? Do you, yes, sir?
I do.
I guess somebody's going to be running
some games.
They have
like minor Jedis and...
Oh, I
want
to play.
That is okay. So if you don't play tabletop games, so I'm sorry, we like geeked out.
I need to, yes.
So people don't understand that when you play a role-playing game, it's you like sitting around with your friends and you're like kind of talking about the scene and you're imagining it. So it's like you're like group imagining like an episode or something together. Okay. So you're talking about the scene and what are you doing and what is your character doing and how are you resolving this, right? So the game master, he's the one who heads that. He's the one who heads the game up and he like tells you what the original setting is and what the objectives are and stuff like that. You don't get to do a lot of playing when you're the game master. So that's why Al was like, but I want to play. Because when you're the game master, you don't really get to play. You're just kind of facilitating and like reeling people.
You do, but you don't.
You're like kind of reeling people back in.
Because you get to play
a
whole bunch of characters.
Yeah.
Well, I think they had done a battleship version in the 90s of like,
yes, they did have a battleship version of Star Wars.
I think we still have that.
That one's fun. But I need to play. We need to get
a date. They even have like Monopoly and stuff. So even if you're not like a hard... Yeah, I was going to say, they've got Trivial Pursuit and Monopoly and stuff. So even if you're not like a hardcore, like you're really into like the hardcore board games and stuff, which is fine.
Yeah.
Let me let everybody know that's fine because I'm kind of tired of all these like uber geeks that are just like, I know everything about this part of fandom and you can't be part of it because you don't know everything. You know there's people,
yeah,
right? You've met them.
Yes,
yeah.
Yes.
So I get really tired of that. And that happens in every branch of fandom, even gaming. So there are all different ways that people can do like Star Wars gaming, even if it's just Monopoly or playing cards or whatever.
Definitely. I have a question from Big Daddy Russell. How many books were written in the Star Wars story?
There's a ton of them.
What kind of books?
Because there's behind the scenes, there's costume, there's...
I think he means the novels. Yeah, he means novels.
There's tons and tons of them.
I would have to look that up because I'm not really sure. And okay, I'm going to say this out loud on the air.
Go ahead, say it.
I've never read any of them, not a single Star Wars book, not one.
Oh, you have to read Under the Empire.
Okay. All right, I'll get it. I love to read. I'm a stupid, crazy reader. I read like all the time.
I need to. Yes. To me, they just need to have a little bit. I'm going to sound so dumb, But they need to have a little bit of picture. Like,
but even comic books.
There's a graphic novel.
Okay. Oh, yes.
The Heir to the Empire, well, actually, of all of these different Star Wars stories.
Okay.
Go to Half Price Books in the graphic novel section. They've got tons of them.
I've always been curious about it's the Syfytonians storyline. And I know there's a book. And then Darth Plagueis. And I know there's a book about that. But you know what gets me mad? So there's all these books. You know, you as a fan, you get excited. You want to read them. But now Disney's saying that that's considered alternate universe.
Right, it's not canon.
It's not canon.
Right, yes. It's not canon.
Which is upsetting because it's like, well, what's the point of me reading these if they're not really going to be
considered? They used to be. The extended universe used to be canon. And then when they did the prequels, Lucas said, nope, not anymore.
Wow.
Well, here's a real interesting thing that I read today, that George Lucas is actually saying that he really thinks people are going to like the new Star Wars.
I read about that. Actually, he hasn't officially commented. That Kathleen Kennedy, the president of Lucasfilms, I don't know if he's commented. I don't know if I don't know if he probably did already comment. But I know he was with Charlie Rose from the CBS, and they did a sit-down interview. And he was kind of not dissing it, but not – he made a comment because they asked – you know, he said that he would never come back to direct Star Wars because he said it's like breaking up with a girlfriend, and you don't go back and you don't visit her, and you don't check in on her. You just move on. But my thing is, okay, well – that's fine, but why do you have to go out there and, you know, put that out there? I don't know. I think when it's something like that, when you've done something like that for so many years, you know, that's been his life, you know, to see someone else who's taking over and who's doing it, you know, it can be challenging. I have my doubts about what Kathleen Kennedy said because I think they probably have him on their contract where it said, you know, you have to say you like it. And probably because when he made that interview with Charlie Rose, there was so much press that was generated over it. So they were probably like, hey, we need to make damage control. I'm just speculating, guys, by the way. but so I don't know. I don't care if he liked it or if he disliked it. I think it's going to be great. I hope it's great. I don't think Disney would do something to screw up such a great. Although I was upset the other day. Have you guys seen that video on YouTube, on Facebook? There's this video that says the first 2 minutes of Star Wars, The Force Awakens.
No.
Yes.
No.
Okay. No. So there's a video.
We are avoiding everything.
I don't want any spoilers.
But no spoilers, promise. So there's a video that says the first 2 minutes. And I was curious because, you know, my concern is I hope that they get the opening crawl correct. And I don't want to see the Disney castle. I love Disney, but not in Star Wars.
Right.
Because that's part of what makes the movie. So I clicked on it and I was like, how the hell did this thing leak? And it looked like someone was shooting with their iPhone from some sort of movie theater or screening room. And so it starts and they show the Disney castle and they show a song that is not the typical one that they show for the opening crawl. The opening crawl starts and, okay, I was already upset because they showed the Disney castle. And then they zoom down what it looks like to be the planet of Jakku. And then Jar Jar pops up. So it was a hoax.
Getting Rickrolled. So
I felt great, yes. I was like, okay, no Disney castle, good.
You're like, I got Rickrolled by Jar Jar.
He's not going to be in the movie.
Jar Jar?
It's from what I read on the interview with Vanity Fair, JJ did something, they were editing, and they were playing with the idea of laying down his bones in the desert of Jakku, but it will be really, really quick. You have to blink. I mean, it's a blink of an eye, which I think that's great because, you know, as they said, they're making this movie for the fans. I didn't have a problem with Jar Jar. I thought it was, but I was a kid when it came out. Now watching it as an adult, I'm like, oh, this is cheesy.
Yeah.
I mean, he's cheesy. Yeah. I mean, it's funny.
But
it's cheesy.
I think people didn't like that aspect of it because
it was racial.
Not so much that. I don't even think it was a race thing. I think it was a more of because in Star Wars there wasn't really comedy. There's a few things here and there that Han says. There's humor, but there's not comedy.
But do you see why they did it, though? If remember, Star Wars Episode 1, we barely see... In the first one, the A New Hope, the original ones, R2-D2 and C-3PO are supposed to represent comedic relief. Mm-hmm. Because it is in reality, a deep film. You know, it talks about mm-hmm. family issues and stuff like that. So they were there to kind of represent the humor and things, which I never laughed at their joke, but I thought they were interesting characters. So
I think 3PO is hilarious.
You go back to Episode 1, and you look at Episode 1, C-3PO, tongue twister, C-3PO is barely in it because he's not under construction, so I could see why they placed Jar Jar there.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I don't think he was that
Yeah,
funny.
I think they were trying to break up the whole, like, we've been looking for this kid. We kind of rip him away from his mother. Sorry, kid, you know, we can buy you, but not your mom. Let's go on all of this. Like, these are all the steps that led him to be what he becomes. There is kind of a darkness to it, you know, and what he has to go through. So I could see them adding Jar Jar in it. Yeah, I never really hated him, but you get stoned.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
You get stoned from your Star Wars friends if you don't hate Jar Jar. So I'm like, oh yeah, Jar Jar, okay.
Yeah, I'm okay with him. I mean, I don't like him.
I mean, like,
him.
I wouldn't want to watch a whole movie about him.
I think it was the fact that there was so much CGI, which there wasn't CGI
in the original.
Yeah.
I mean, even when it was remastered, you can see where they're when the ships are going through. You can see the blockiness when it first came out because they didn't do it right.
And the
green screen.
What's his name?
The TIE Fighter?
No.
Jabba.
Remember, A New Hope, when they did the special editions.
Where Han was talking to him?
Yeah.
Because Jabba was just supposed to be like a humanoid.
Well, if you look at Jabba, if you look at when they were first released in 1995, the special editions, and you look at Jabba now in the Blu-ray edition, they reworked it. Because back then, I saw a comparison on YouTube of 1996, and now, and they've made it better.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what I thought. I'm gonna get stoned for this one, so get ready.
Okay, I'm ready.
I thought for the Blu-ray they should have, for the Empire Strikes Back, even though I thought Frank Oz did an amazing job with the puppeteering. I mean, that in itself deserved an Oscar. I thought because you know in the Blu-rays they digitized the Yoda from A New Hope because that was a nappy puppet. It was just terrible. And I thought they should have done the same for The Empire Strikes Back, just to see what he looked like CGI.
Oh,
I don't know. I'm going to get stoned.
Oh.
I don't know. I was just curious.
He's a lot older, though.
Yes.
But the whole, like, there's part of you that, like, gasps and loves it when he's there with the saber and he's bouncing around, right, and he's doing everything. And then there's kind of part of you that goes, oh.
You know what? What I liked about the Yoda from The Empire Strikes Back, as opposed to the CGI Yoda, you see the Yoda from The Empire Strikes Back in Return of the Jedi, and you feel for him, and you relate to him. And, I mean, you somewhat feel that connection to this wise person. The digital Yoda, at times, it's you know it's him, but you just don't, I don't know, like, at times, it's kind of like in and out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree.
I can't explain the feeling, but there's something there, it's just... Like, it's not fully working. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And with the other one, it's just you just connected. Like, there's something. Like, you just wanted to cry on your worst day ever. You just want to go to Yoda and be like, from the Empire Strikes Back, oh, my gosh, I'm having a horrible day. And
yes.
The other
and
one,
he's
it's
like the master, you know. He, like, leads you through it, right?
Yeah.
And helps you face yourself, you know. He's Yoda.
I hope, I don't know, somehow they fit him force in.
Some kind of, mention or
they
something.
They have to, because he was at Return of the end of Return of the Jedi.
Mm-hmm.
Spoiler alert, no, everybody has seen it.
if you haven't, too bad for you.
But I don't know, that would be great if they show some sort of force. And it's rumored Hayden Christensen's coming back. So how would you guys feel about him popping up?
I didn't hate him. I don't know why everybody hated him.
He looked like he was, you know.
But he's supposed to look like he's in pain and anguish.
He looked lost.
He looks constipated. That's what people always say, that he looks constipated.
But that's
the
thing.
Time.
He was lost.
He was.
No, I mean, lost is in, I don't know why I'm in this movie kind of lost.
Yeah, well, the chemistry.
There was no chemistry.
Yes, I agree with you. I did not feel that. But, you know, you just have to love them, for what they.
I think you feel it because you know those characters.
Yeah.
So you should feel that chemistry, even if the actors aren't great with it. like in your imagination, in your heart or whatever, you feel that because you know like where they came from, where they end up, because you've seen the ones, you know, with Harrison Ford and with everybody, and you know like how they end up. So I don't know.
But something similar is going to happen this coming November with Harry Potter, the sequel.
Oh,
so
they're going to do the pre,
which don't have Harry Potter in them. The something.
No,
of the
I thought they were going to do the stuff with the beans. Not the Sorcerer's Stone, not the people that had those three things, but somebody else from like pre Lily and James,
yes.
Okay,
because I knew they were doing the one about the Book of Dangerous Creatures or whatever.
The Book of Dangerous Creatures, I thought they were going to do as a play.
No, they're doing one of, it has Eddie, he's now in that new film that's getting Oscar buzz, The Danish Woman.
Oh my God, that
Eddie,
looks so good.
He's in that film. He's the main character. I just hope it's...
He's the one that was Stephen Hawking.
Yes.
Beautiful Mind, right? Or
he started off as a Burberry porcelain model.
Oh, did he?
And, you know, he's gone from a model to a big career. So, but anyways, moving on. Star Wars.
Sorry.
We love Harry Potter also. Yeah,
that was the theory of everything.
The theory of everything. Yeah, that was it. Beautiful Mind was Russell
Crowe. Russell Crowe. Yes, 2001.
But yes, so they're doing Harry. Mm-hmm. Oh, God. They're doing Harry Potter like before. So how are we going to feel about it? I don't know, because it's probably not going to even touch on anybody that we knew from the universes. We all want her to just, you know... Sorry, shit, or get off the pot. We want her to like move on with Harry's kids and like
language.
Hermione's kids. Language. Well, yes, no. She needs to write us stuff about what their children are doing.
I think she will, and I'll tell you why. Star Wars for
she
one
won't.
Was going Star, Star Wars was for a while dead, and then Disney rescued it. Not rescued it, but they bought it. And now, you know, the story continues. So I feel like because the movie has already made probably all of its budget. So when a lot of these studios, because these are like brands, these are licenses, you know, they're going to live on forever. So I think once Warner Brothers and the J.K. Rowling find out that there's money to be made there, they'll hopefully write an 8, oh, a 9, 10, 11th book.
That would be great. I would love to see that.
Daniel Radcliffe is not, you know, he's doing a lot of indie films, but he's not.
He's in that new Victor Frankenstein that I want to see. He's Igor.
Which flopped.
Did it?
It was one of the top 20 bombs of 2015.
Really?
I'm sorry. The movie was
filmed. It looked kind of cheesy to me. I don't know.
It was filmed 2013, and it was not released until now. So that's usually not a good sign.
Yeah, I know.
But I haven't seen it. I can't judge it. I haven't seen it. I just... what I read.
I mean, it was like... what was that other movie we went to go see, and we were like... dang, that movie's
Fantastic
at the dollar
Four.
Already? No. We don't talk about that movie
okay.
here ever. Yeah.
No.
Was it Jim that we were surprised it was already at the dollar?
Yes.
Oh, they pulled that out 2 weeks in
yeah,
the movie theaters?
Yeah, 2 weeks. 2 weeks.
And they pulled that out.
Because we were like, oh, God, I guess we've got to go see it, because we told everybody on the show we'd go see it and review it.
And it was at the
and
dollar.
Then it was already at the dollar. We were like, what the heck happened? And then 2 weeks, gone. Gone forever. Gone.
But I'm like, who
it wasn't that bad.
It wasn't Jim. It should have been like...
the 80s.
Like
authentic 80s.
Pitch Perfect 3 or something. I don't know.
Yeah.
It should have been like, you know, it should have had a different title. And then everybody would have been fine with it.
But it was the beginnings
of
Jim and the Holograms.
Nah. It had no Jim, nothing. Boo.
But it was like Josie and the Pussycats. Remember they had done a film version? And
Yeah. It was that kind of... it was still that kind of thing. So it was a cute movie if you didn't think of it as a Jim movie.
Yeah.
It's kind of like Starship Troopers. It was neat as Bugs in Space, but it wasn't Starship Troopers.
Oh, yeah. No, definitely no. Yeah, you have to watch that movie and just be like, this is a fun movie for all of its cheesy campiness and like the brain bug and everything. Like,
yeah.
You've got to love Starship Troopers for what it is. But if you wanted it to be like... a Heinlein book, forget it. Like, no, you know, they should make Stranger in a Strange Land. No, that would upset a lot of people. They should never make that.
They should make it so I don't have to read
so
the
you
book.
Don't have to read the book.
Yeah.
Well, I've been trying to get Vincent to read books for a long time.
What have you read?
Nothing. No, he doesn't read.
What are you trying to get him to read?
I want him to read Stranger in a Strange Land.
Okay.
I think
okay.
he would really
I've
like
read
it.
Books. I just haven't read any recently.
Which books have you read?
50 Shades of Grey doesn't count.
No,
he would never.
I've read all the tokens.
Okay.
I've read do androids dream of electric sheep?
Didn't you really read that?
AKA Blade Runner.
Blade Runner, because he has every version of Blade Runner. He has VHS,
yes,
DVD, Blu-ray, director's cut. Yeah. Yes, he loves that. We'll have to have you come over, okay, and we'll sit on the couch and make popcorn and we'll watch Blade
Runner. I do like Ridley Scott.
Yes.
I did not like The Martian, but I did like Ridley Scott.
Oh, why didn't you like The Martian?
I didn't like it. I don't know.
Oh, I liked it. I really felt for him. I saw another
thing about that.
Matt Damon didn't do it for me.
On The Martian, that Matt Damon was dressed up as BB-8.
Yes, the colors. Yes.
Yeah, the colors.
Yes. Yes.
That's funny. Oh, speaking of books, by the way, I looked and I tried to count on this website that had all the books listed. From what I could count, I might be off a little because I was trying to count really fast, 220 Star Wars books have been released.
220
Star Wars books have been released, yeah. That's not counting the children's. There was a whole children's section of books, too.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
Yeah, but there's this whole back stuff that you don't even see. Like, even after the episode one, Darth Maul, he's still alive.
Clone Wars, yes.
Yeah. After getting chopped in half, he's still alive.
That's insane.
Is he part worm?
Well, it's his...
his tribe.
His race, or whatever he is. And also the training that he went through. What is it called? Because I used to play the video game Terra something. Terra Messiah or whatever. But it's training to battle Jedi's without having power, so they can't like manipulate you with their mind tricks.
Oh, really? Oh, that's cool. What? Okay.
And his thing was, if he were to get like electrocuted, if like the Emperor were like electrocuted, he could survive that.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. Oh, that's cool. You would think a lot of them would try and be trying to get that training. All right. Whoa. What was the name of that video game? It had to have been from the 80s. Where it's the AT-ATs, right? Mm-hmm. And you had to fly and you had to hit that little square that was like that big. Do you remember that game?
Star Wars?
It was a video game. It was just called Star Wars?
Yeah.
Was that all it was called?
Yeah.
Oh my God, that video game agitated the crap out of me. It was the AT-AT. You know which ones the AT-ATs are, right?
They're the ones, the big walking ones.
They look like four-legged things. Okay. So in the video games, there was a little colored square, and I'm talking like this big on the screen, like tiny little square, and you're in your ship, like flying up and down.
Yes, it's like it has the stick thing.
And then you had to try to shoot that little tiny square.
Oh, I think I've seen it. It has that stick thingy that you play with.
That was on the, what was it, Atari or?
Atari. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's like a stick. Yeah, yeah. And then you had to move that around and try to move your stupid ship and then hit the one button.
It's like the anti-Pac-Man.
Yes, video game. Was so agonizing. I wanted to play through that video game and I couldn't.
I don't know. I think the only Star Wars video game that I've played was
Lego Star Wars.
No, I've never even played that. No, I played. It was back when there was Nintendo, when like you know you had to take out the thing and
roll it and
put it back in there. It was in 1990s, and it was the cassettes look almost like VHS.
Mm-hmm.
And they were, is it 8-bit? That's the name of the texture?
Yeah, yeah.
It looked like a little thingy. And I played The Empire Strikes Back, and I had fun with that one because the lightsaber was cool. But I think that was
on the Super NES.
Super Nintendo.
Yeah.
But I never got past the Hoth thing, so mm-hmm. I always wanted to fight Darth Vader. And it never got there.
My favorite video game of all time is Star Wars Masters of Terror, whatever. But it's a fighting game. Nobody likes it. And it was on PlayStation. Not PS2. It's just PlayStation.
What was that other one you had where it came in like the metal tin and...
Oh, yeah. Was it
The Force Unleashed?
Force Unleashed, yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
I've seen that one.
Yeah. That one was always looked like really mm-hmm. cool and stuff.
X-Wing and TIE Fighter, LucasArts.
Oh, yeah. The agony of these video games.
On greatoldgames.com.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Full Throttle, LucasArts. That was a good game.
I'm waiting for them to do Secret Weapons of the Luftwaffe.
Well, the thing that I'm shocked is that they're not doing a video game for The Force Awakens. I mean, even though Battlefront is... supposed to tie in to the they just wanted to sell more video games
mm-hmm.
But I usually for these films, there's usually like an official video game of the film. So I'm shocked that they haven't done that.
Too. Maybe they're gonna wait.
Just once they want to do it right.
Maybe they'll do Legos. Force Awakens Legos. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Lego has everything. It's Lego, like Lego
yeah.
everything.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm Lego Batman.
Well, the there was a Darth Maul one that they never released.
A video game?
A video game.
Really?
Where he was like the main character.
Dude, and then the and other
it was
things,
after he got chopped in half.
Speaking of Darth Maul for now and forever, because I saw that piece about the Disney pop-up restaurant and that Darth Maul like soup that they did or whatever.
Was it good?
I don't know. I didn't taste it. We just saw the picture of it. It looked like Darth Maul, though. It was really creepy. Like, it was kind of cool. You like eating Darth Maul's face, but it was kind of cool.
Oh, it's like red and it has like
something. Yeah. I would love to do like a Star Wars themed party where we had like Star Wars food and stuff like that. Obviously, like cookies and stuff is like super easy. You can cut out because they're Star Wars, you know, cookie cutters and stuff like that. But
Yoda soda. Yeah. I don't know. Wampa. Huh?
Bantha nuggets.
Oh, yeah, you can paint them brown and you're eating them.
No, you can have Dagobah like swamp stew. Yes. It's green.
But like gourmet, because there's a book out of the Star Wars food.
Yeah.
But I don't know, like the food looks right, but it's something like gourmet, like something like tasteful and something.
But yeah, see how it even reaches into something like that. Like you can really go out into this fandom and it's everywhere. It's just like everywhere. I mean, there's toys, there's food, there's games, there's movies, there's video games, there's cereal. Yes, we took pictures of the cereal actually the other day. Clothing, so much clothing.
They've gone crazy with mm-hmm. the clothing. I think now this year I've seen more Star Wars clothing mm-hmm. than ever, because before you really had to go to the StarWars.com or really dig in there. But we were talking about JCPenney's earlier, like how they have
you had to go to cons to get Star Wars shirts.
Yeah,
well, Lucas made more money on merchandising than he did on the movie.
He negotiated that was his thing. He said he wanted to get the sequel rights and he wanted to get the merchandising rights, and because back then movies weren't marketed with toys, you know, the Planet of the Apes had done that, but people didn't buy, so they were unsuccessful.
Yeah,
but with Lucasfilm, with Star Wars, I mean, they were the first one to really market a film with toys, and it was successful. So look at Force Friday.
Yeah, and George Lucas is just a smart man.
Yeah.
I don't care how mad everybody is at him. He's a smart man. Yeah. Living large. Living large because he's a smart man. And you should have, I mean.
See, because everybody that says they didn't like the first one, well, he is still paid to see two and three.
Yeah. I'll admit, I saw all three prequels, but I only went opening night for the first one.
Well, I just think you have to. Some part of you somewhere, if you like this, you have to give him props.
Yeah.
Like you do. This came from his vision, from him wanting this to happen. You know, he's helped to push, like you said, the forefront of movies. You know, he's been out there getting it done.
I watched an interview recently because I've been crazy about what he has to say. So I've been like scavenging, and then because of Syfytonians episode 2, I've been doing a lot of research. So I've been floating the internet looking for stuff, and I saw that he's not even a member because they asked him if he goes to the Oscars, which, fun fact, New Hope had several Oscar nominations. Didn't win, but it had several Oscars. It won some stuff, but so I thought that was cool. It's like, okay, recognized by the Academy.
Yeah, why didn't it get special effects?
Really? Yeah, it should have.
But George Lucas is not a part of the Hollywood Foreign Press he's not part of the guild.
Mm-hmm.
They try to give him a hard time when making the second and third one because there were certain guidelines that he had to follow by. And he said, okay, well, I don't want to be a part of this guild. And because of that, I think he couldn't direct the sequel to the Empire. And no, to the Return of the Jedi, he could not direct it. Mm-hmm. Because he was not part of the union, which I don't know. I don't understand how those things work.
Yeah, there's all these rules about who can do what. And I don't understand it because in Texas, we're not a union state. So
it's a movie. But yeah, I thought that was it. And to me, I felt like it was very relatable. It's like, you know, he loves the aspect of storytelling. He's not just a corporation. He's not just someone who's trying to, take advantage of something that's been successful. And, you know, so I thought that was very interesting that he still has that kind of mindset.
Mm-hmm. So you have your story that you want to get out there to all of us, because you're a storyteller too. Yes. So if people haven't seen the first Syfytonians, just a little, you know, background for you guys. So Alejandro did a documentary about the comic convention scene here in San Antonio, and he went to Alamo City Comic Con, and he talked to cosplayers, and he talked to different people in the community. So this new documentary that you're working on, it's Syfytonians 2.
So it's Syfytonians Episode 2, because it's kind of like the continuation, but it's called The Phantom Reawakens, and that's referring to Star Wars, because we are somewhat reawakening ourselves. We're somewhat dusting off, you know, our Jedi capes and kind of reconnecting with that part of our lives. So that was where the idea for the title came from. But this one's exciting. I'm having so much fun on this one, because it's just Star Wars. It's challenging, as mm-hmm. can't say the word. because, you know, the first one was focused on the Alamo City Comic Con and the effect that it's had in the community. This is just strictly Star Wars fans. It has maybe 3 minutes of the Alamo City Comic Con, but it's not focused on that. This is just all about Star Wars. So it's been great as a storyteller. It's been challenging to me because of the first Syfytonians, people have this kind of expectation of what it's supposed to be. And so maybe it's just me and myself, but they say you're your worst enemy, you're your worst critic.
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
I'm kind of like, this one has to be off the chain. I'm thinking of submitting this one to the Lucasfilm Film Festival competition.
Oh yeah, nice. Yes, you
I want to put out for my city. This is San Antonio. I'm not from here, but I feel like I'm from here. And they never show us in any of these documentaries or films. So I was like, you know, we have so much great things happening here, and so. Mm-hmm. And it's Star Wars. I want to show how crazy we are about Star Wars. So,
well, I thought the first Syfytonians was really fabulous.
Thank you.
So, not to put any more pressure on you, but yes. It was fabulous. So you do. I feel what you're saying is you do need to step this next one up, because now we all kind of have that expectation of you of, well, this is going to totally like blow us away, right?
Now, you went into the first one not necessarily knowing much about it.
Yeah.
So how did this one play different? How is this one going to play differently, since it's a little closer to your heart and you know a lot more about it than you did, per se, about the comic book conventions?
So how is it going to play differently? Like, in what sense?
In how do you separate yourself a little more than from
the personal aspect,
right?
You know, it's I have my moments where I kind of geek out, you mm-hmm. know, like I'll see something I think the craziest thing was when I got to interview Daniel Fleetwood. I went up to Houston and I went to Springs, Texas. You know, Daniel Fleetwood was the Star Wars fan who had cancer, who his last wish was to watch The Force Awakens. And I found out they lived here in Houston. And so I contacted them. The wife was so nice. You know, she let me go visit them. And a part of me was excited, because this was a story that had become over the world. They had people from China, different places. So, you know, you get there and you're excited because you feel you're so connected to the world. And it's so crazy, you know, how small the world is. And you get there, and I think the thing that I had to kind of disconnect myself, my personal aspect, because, you know, when I saw him, he was in a very, very fragile position. I've never seen someone as white as paper. And it was a challenging interview. So there's so many mixed emotions. That's an example of that. When I see, like, I went and they were building the R2-D2, and I got excited for that.
Oh, you went and saw Jason?
Yes. Hopefully we're going to get... Jamie McChan. Is it McChan? Jamie, I'm sorry if I got screwed up your last name. But he was there with Jason because Jason's building the R2-D2 unit.
So hopefully we're going to get to go this weekend and interview Jason as well.
Yes, yes.
Because Jason does Nerd 411, so he actually does another geeky – he does a podcast. Yes. He doesn't do the video cast like we do. But he's been a friend of ours forever and ever. So he wants to – you know, we want to show it off and show because it's a lot of work and effort. And it's going to be super great when it's done though, right?
But, you learn to kind of – disconnect yourself, and I don't know, I sometimes I get my fear is that I don't want to come off on camera like if I'm just an outsider, because you know, you have to be neutral and you can't, you know,
right?
So, but I'm a big fan. Yes.
The one thing that I was wondering about is like how you're gonna be able to do that when you're so engulfed and you really like Star Wars, and you have to still be, well, I still need to be professional.
I mean,
I think it's a little bit harder.
Yes, and it's challenging because then you want to show your excitement, but then you don't want to come off like you're not interested.
Or
but
you also want to ask them about aspects that personally interest you, them. Right?
But
and
I know
you're
those...
like, I've got to ask them about all of this stuff, right?
And I know what interests me. I think the best way that I put it is, the urban journalist, you know, he is a separate person. You know, what you see on the in front of the camera, he's different. Alejandro is just crazy and outrageous. The urban journalist is professional. He represents the audience. It's not about him. He's kind of like an avatar of the audience, and he's there. And so I know when I ask the questions, I'm not representing myself. I'm representing the audience, and there are people that don't understand how big Star Wars is. So I'm kind of approaching it from that point of view of like, what is it so big? And it's kind of like my way of saying, let me show you. This is why it's big. And this is why you're a part of it.
Mm-hmm.
So, but yes. And I also did with the trailer. Can I talk about it?
Yes.
Yeah, definitely.
I did a GoFundMe campaign. Because of all the footage that we're filming, it's about, with the last one, it was 450 hours. With this, to make an hour, I had to film so much. I ran out of space. So I did a GoFundMe just because this is independent.
Right.
No studio, unfortunately. But then if I had a studio, I couldn't tell a story that I wanted to tell.
Right.
So people can donate. I don't know the address. So
we'll put it up on the Facebook. Yeah.
Yes. Mm-hmm. But I'm excited. It's fun. And you guys are a part of it. I can't wait to... I love both of these people. The first time that
like
I met them, and I was like, they have to be... in Syfytonians. And then last weekend when you were talking about your toys, I was like, oh my gosh, like they really are fans. Because like, I thought your thing was the Ninja Turtles. And it is still that too. But when I saw how much knowledge, I was like, this girl, like, oh my gosh, I have to get them in there. So
I've been a geek. I've always been a geek. I grew up when I was a kid. My dad used to watch Doctor Who, Tom Baker, on PBS when it was still on PBS back in the day. And I grew up with Star Trek, and I watched it with the Tribbles and everything. And I'm a geek. I played Dungeons and Dragons when I was 12. Like, I am a geek. Wait. There are lots of different. I'm a little bit of a different geek than most people.
You're
because
a fabulous geek.
Thank you. I like a lot of different aspects of fandom. I like the Turtles. I'm really into Star Wars. I like Star Trek and Star Wars, which is hard to find sometimes in people, but I really love them both. I love 1980s cartoons. Like, I'm a super geek for 80s cartoons.
But
I like
now that we watch them. Not so great.
Yeah.
Yeah. No. Sometimes I'm kind of sad. Like, I don't want to go back and watch stuff. I'm sure I've told everybody the Gremlins story like a million times, but I like, have you ever seen the movie Gremlins?
I've never seen it. I know.
Didn't we have this conversation already?
I know.
Last time he was on?
I know what it
Gremlins.
Is.
So I get like all of these things that I love from when I was a kid and I think they're like super fabulous or whatever. And then I try to get my children to watch it and I like get them all prepared and it's going to be like that. No, then they're laughing at me. They're like, this is the stupidest thing I've ever seen. Like, they'll still watch it with me and they love me because they're my kids. But they're like, this is ridiculous. Why are you watching it? The only thing that we ever saw that was like a scary movie that our children actually thought was scary was Evil Dead.
Okay, never seen that.
Oh my God.
I saw that recently. Okay. I saw that recently.
You saw the newest one or the first
one?
The
first one.
Okay.
Because
okay.
I was like, well, I want to see, I don't want to, because remakes usually have the tendency of not being so good.
The remake was pretty decent.
So I haven't seen the remake, but I saw the original one.
The remake was pretty decent. Yeah.
I just,
Well, the original is it. That's the one that does.
I love that the original has some, because again, Lucasfilm, Steven Spielberg, best friends, that it has some Star Wars stuff.
Yeah.
And I love that it was authentic to the times.
And I love that about E.T. And mm-hmm. did you see all that? Like, I bet people didn't even know, but I have the Hammerhead toy. And so, you know, they're playing with it in the movie. And then I bet people didn't even realize it. Like, those of us that love it, we realize that people from E.T.'s planet are in the council chambers there.
Episode one.
Yes. Yes. So, like, right away, we're all like, oh, my God, it's E.T., right? Because we're kids of the 80s, right? But now that's really circulating on Facebook. Everybody's super excited about it. I'm like, everybody knew that, but apparently everybody didn't know that. But
this looks like a transfer, like, kind of a reincarnation of E.T.
He's like, I'm phone home.
But he went, this toy made it. There was a scene in the movie with the toy where what's his, what's the name of the
Elliot.
San Antonio.
Elliot.
He's showing
Henry Thomas.
He's showing him the Star Wars toys,
yes,
which I thought that was
he's
cool.
He's telling him about Star Wars, so and that's pretty cool. And have you seen the whole link about how E.T. is really
is
a Jedi?
Yeah.
And he makes the bike go up and everything, and he's using the Force and stuff. I think that's pretty cute, actually. Mm-hmm. It's pretty funny.
I saw one of how there was a female Yoda in episode one. And there was. I remember looking at it, but they kind of phased her out. And they, I saw this post, I have to send it to you. I saw this post recently of how, like, they showed her story and everything. So there was a female, they called her Yaddo or Yudo or something, like, it was similar
to Yoda.
Yes, yes.
I'll have to go back. Well, we're going to start watching it on the 17th at 10 o'clock at night here at the house. We're going to start with episode one, go all the way to six. And then on the 18th, we're going to go see seven at noon. Mm-hmm. So we're going to do the whole, you know, watch it again. Yeah, because we have to watch it. So when should we be looking for your film to come out?
Okay, so actually, I'm glad that I came here because I was going to make the announcement here. They don't know about this. I'm about to say right now.
Okay, yeah.
So
I'm excited.
And you're listening to it here on
you're
Geek Out of Say live.
So people can actually see the first clip of Syfytonians before it comes out. It doesn't come out for at least another 10 months because I'm still filming.
Yep.
People can see the first clip before 10 months this month, and I will show it here, only here, exclusively to Geek Out of Say. If we reach our goal on the GoFundMe page by January 1st, so okay. When we reach our goal by January 1st, I will come here and I will give them the first 2 minutes of Syfytonians episode 2.
Nice.
The clip. Very and cool. No one else. Only Geek Out of Say.
Sweet.
Not even on my page. So
nice.
Help us
That's
get there.
Awesome. Yes.
Yes, definitely.
Go help him. I don't think people realize how much it takes. For Vincent and I, we do this live and we're just talking and it looks like we're hanging out, but people don't realize that the cameras cost money and the mics cost money and the internet costs money and, you know, everything costs money for us to do.
The website costs money.
Yeah. So we feel you.
Yeah.
We definitely know what you're talking about, and then all the time and effort and what you have to do, and you have to drive around town to get footage.
Yes.
And yes, it adds up.
I'm not going to lie. It was uncomfortable. Like, considering the GoFundMe page, because I'm not one, you know, I'm very independent. I'm not one to, like, make stuff like that. And but, you know, unfortunately, when you're a young filmmaker and, you know, there's all these expenses and all these things, you know.
Well, and people are enjoying it. So if they think of it as a way of, well, if it was a movie that I saw in the theater, and the documentary is really that good. Like, if you haven't seen the first one, you should go, because it is like seeing a documentary that you would see.
A legitimate documentary.
No, I love you. And
thank you. I love you too.
When I first heard about it, I was like, yikes, I'm sorry.
No, it's okay.
This guy from San Antonio is making a documentary.
Yes.
But, you know, Apple had asked us, like, you know, be cool with this guy, and we were like, okay. And we met you and we loved you, but we still didn't know, like, what your film was going to be like. So we were like, okay, we love him, so even if it's terrible, like, this is our game plan, right? Like, what we're going to do, right? And then we went and saw it, and it was fabulous. Like, we were taken aback by, like, how fabulous it
was.
So don't think of the GoFundMe as, like, just throwing money at Alejandro. Just think of it as, like, a movie price. So, you know, if you and your friends are going to watch it, you're paying a little movie price. They're just paying it up front before it comes out.
And I, you know, and donate whatever. I don't, you know, if you don't have 20 bucks, don't donate 20 bucks. If you have, you know, whatever you can, a dollar is a dollar. We're right now three donations, $50. And I was celebrating because I was like, look, $50 is better than nothing. $50 adds up. So, you know, and it's not, this is for the story. I, you know, like I said, I want the story to be great. I want it to compete. I want to show our city. This is not about me. Mm-hmm. This is about our city. This is about, I don't know. I hope that this thing, and I'm not being pretentious. I hope that this story goes somewhere, and I hope that it opens doors for San Antonio. And I hope, could you imagine if we got exclusives for the next coming up Star Wars films here in San Antonio? That'd be great. You know, forget San Diego. What about us, you know? Mm-hmm. So I want to show that side of San Antonio.
Yeah, and I think you've done a really good job. We talked about this a little bit before, and I want to touch it really quick before we go because I know we're past our time. But people were worried about you doing the Alamo City because they thought that you were just doing it for, you know, the person who created Alamo City and just to stroke, you know, people's egos and things like that. That's not how it turned out at all. I can tell you personally from knowing Alejandro, he has reached out to a lot of us in the fandom and in the Star Wars community, and he's found out some things because he didn't even know about the whole gaming aspect. So he's going to be out there looking at everything and talking to everybody. So it's not just going to be one group's vantage point of the fandom. Like, he's going to be going out there talking to a lot of people over the next, you know, few months and stuff. So this is going to truly be a whole San Antonio, you know, documentary. So that was my soapbox. I'll get off of it now. And but go to his GoFundMe, support him, definitely. Check out the first one, check out the teaser.
Yeah, definitely go his GoFundMe, and we'll go ahead and post that up later on Facebook. Alejandro, thanks for coming by.
Thank
again.
You for
we
having
love
me.
Having you.
Yes,
it,
I love
we
coming.
Always have a great
Thomas
conversation when we come here.
Even when I'm not here, I watch you. So
thank you so much. Yes, he does.
And then
I guess we'll talk about our geeky shows next week.
Yeah, we'll talk about it next week. But
I always do this to them.
You're okay. Yes, you're fine.
But it's good. We had a good conversation.
Yeah.
But again, Alejandro, Syfytonians 2, check it out. You can see the trailer on YouTube. And you just saw it here on Geek at SA. I'm Vince.
I'm Alejandro.
I'm Colleen.
Geek at SA. Oh.
Geek at SA.
He stole his line.